Hello YouTubers, my name is Frederick Lopez and you are on the Dark Knight of Steel channel. In anticipation for Lego Batman, I decided to share with you some of my favorite Batman video games and favorite Batman films. Now, this is going to be my top 10 favorite Batman films. This includes live action releases as well as animated films, whether theatrically or on video / DVD. Now, this is my personal opinion. You don't have to agree with this list. If you disagree, let me know some of your favorites in the comments below or make your own list. These are my personal favorite Batman films. Yeah, before I continue this video, some honorable mentions are Batman Sub-Zero, Batman Year One, and Justice League Doom. Starting at number 10 is Batman Returns from 1992. I like this film. It's the last one Tim Burton did. And it's very dark, a lot darker than Batman 89, and it has a bit of tragedy and type of goth feeling to it. It's the darkest Batman. In a way, the first Batman from 89 was more like the 30s Batman. This one's a 90s Batman. It has Michael Keaton returning as Batman Bruce Wayne, Danny DeVito as the Penguin, and Michelle Pfeiffer as Selina Kyle / Catwoman, with Christopher Walken as a villain named Max Schreck. Yeah, this is an enjoyable film, but it's number 10 on my list. It's not my favorite Batman. It's leaps and bounds better than Batman and Robin. But something about it didn't quite reach the levels of Batman 89 or have that much enjoyment like Batman Forever, personally for me. And that doesn't negate this film. The only cons I would have of this film is the Penguin's portrayal of just being kind of like this underwater sewer fish person. He's very different than the Penguin from the comics and even cartoons. But Tim Burton brings kind of his own spin on it. This is a Tim Burton Batman here, much more than Batman 89. And the only thing I would have against this film, they try to do too much. There's just too many stories, too many antagonists. There's Penguin story, there's Michelle Pfeiffer, Selina Kyle, there's Max Schreck. All of it is really kind of tied to Max Schreck as a main villain, and then there's just Batman. One problem I have with the Batman anthology is that Batman plays second fiddle to the villains. The villains are the star of the show, and Batman really doesn't get much to do. He's just kind of there. But I do like certain elements of his character. I do like how he goes night after night investigating. He never quits being Batman. He's always Batman, whether he's as Bruce Wayne or in the bat suit, and I like that in this film. I like the romance between him and Selina Kyle. Some of the effects of the Batmobile action scene where the Penguin sabotages a Batmobile. The fights and all-around kind of tragic tone to the film. Danny Elfman's score, the original song Face to Face. There's a lot of stuff to like in this movie, but some of the other stuff just kind of bogs it down for me. That is not a bad film. It's just not as... I don't like it as much as the other films that I'm about to mention. But yeah, I grew up with Michael Keaton's Batman. And it's a shame that we didn't get one more, because I feel like it could have maybe had the best of both worlds of 89 and Returns. But Tim Burton has this kind of like interesting take. It makes it darker and kind of just elevates everything that was started in 89 in this film. Number 9 on my list is Batman Forever from 1995. Tim Burton moved down to producer, and Joel Schumacher directed it. This film is really light. In a way, this can be the downfall of Batman, but I feel like people tie Batman and Robin and Batman Forever together. There's a lot of issues in this that carry on to Batman and Robin. But Batman Forever, people forget, is actually a lot darker of a film than Batman and Robin. It's almost like the in-between of Tim Burton and Batman and Robin. It just doesn't know which one to be. And in a way, it's almost like you had the 30s comics. Returns was kind of more like the 90s. This one's like the 40s, going on to the 50s, before you get to the 60s. So it's weird how the films follow the tone of the comic books of Batman. But yeah, it gets more right than it does wrong. It's campy. Two-Face is just basically kind of like a Joker 2.0. It looks really silly after seeing Aaron Eckhart's, but you have Robin introduced. Arkham Asylum's finally mentioned. We kind of have more of an athletic Bruce Wayne. I feel like Val Kilmer's very underrated. As a kid, I thought Batman was the same, and I was wondering, who's Bruce Wayne? He's almost like the same person in the Batsuit as Michael Keaton's, and very underrated in my opinion. People remember George Clooney more than they do Val Kilmer, and that's sad because I thought Val Kilmer was a very, very underrated Batman. A little wooden at times, yes, but I thought he was very underrated. Jim Carrey is larger than life as the Riddler. Jim Carrey to this film is what Jack Nicholson was to Batman 89. And some of the redesigns I like. Some of the cities are more neon. I don't like the nipples on the suit. Who would put nipples on the bat suit? Certain creative decisions I didn't like as much, and they made it more child-friendly after the backlash in Batman Returns, and I didn't like that. But there are certain dark elements that I wish were explored more. Certain deleted scenes had the Red Book subplot that were just great. I feel like they could have been focused and just featured more in the film. But other than that, it has been dated. It feels like a 90s film. It's like the bat signal is not a beeper, Miss Meridian. Stuff like that. But it does have its thrills and all around just excitement. And it's my second favorite in the Batman anthology under 89. And for me, even though it has aged a bit and is a bit 90s and just kind of like flamboyant and almost like campy, it still has dark elements and it still has stuff from the comics, and it gets more right than it does wrong, in my opinion, even with Two-Face and everything. It's one of more of those things where it's like a missed opportunity where you wonder what film it could have been, but it's not as bad as Batman and Robin, and I enjoyed it more than the other two films. Plus, you have Hold Me, Thrill Me, Kiss Me, Kill Me by U2, and Kiss From a Rose by Seal, near Valentine's Day, Kiss From a Rose. Every time I hear that song, I'm like, Batman Forever, yeah. Nicole Kidman as Dr. Chase Meridian. Just everything just has an all-around exciting vibe to it, and it's just an enjoyable film that is kind of underrated, in my opinion, with Val Kilmer's performance as Batman. Even Bob Kane, before he passed away at the time, thought that that was the best incarnation of Batman. So, if you haven't checked out Batman Forever, check it out. It's slightly better than Batman and Robin, but that's not saying much. Number 8 on my list is probably the most polarizing film out of the bunch, and very divided, and probably the most controversial, and that is Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. I've made many videos defending this film, but no matter how you feel about the film, we all can agree, besides Hans Zimmer's score being awesome, Ben Affleck killed it as Batman. He was the Dark Knight Returns come to life. I like Ben Affleck's portrayal in this. I trusted Warner Brothers' judgment in a way. It was kind of a feat to really kind of improve upon Christian Bale's. I still like Christian Bale in many areas, but with the voice and the way they have it, Christian Bale is a comic book based Batman. Ben Affleck is a comic book adapted. He is straight from the comic pages. And he's almost like the animated series and comic book Batmans combined. I can't wait to see more of him, and I want to see what he's capable of. I haven't seen his full range yet, but with the armor suit and the short ears, they made it work. He's larger than life. He's the tallest Batman, and I love the scenes in this of showing an older Bruce Wayne slash Batman. Robin's already been killed by the Joker. He's older. We get to see how that affects him, and in a way, he goes from a birth and then rebirth at the end when, with everything that happens with Superman, he finds himself again. So it's almost like a spiritual journey in a way. But it's great regarding Batman. Yes, he does somewhat kill, but in the comics he does it, and then how the hell do you explain Michael Keaton lighting a guy on fire with a Batmobile, or Christian Bale knocking Two-Face out, or what about that 18-wheeler guy? The underpass, if Batmobile plays chicken and hits an 18-wheeler head-on, that guy didn't live. I'm sure he's okay under the overpass. Yeah, I disagree with the stuff about Batman killing. But besides his plot issues and stuff and what people may think, Ben Affleck nailed it as Batman. And I'm not too afraid about the future regarding his performance. Other stuff is kind of left in the open, but he brought a very good portrayal, and it was almost like seeing the video game Batman as well, fighting, just everything. I've talked about this film in many videos, but it makes my number 8 list. Number 7 on my list is a better Superman-Batman movie. No, not the Batman-Superman movie, but Superman-Batman Public Enemies. Tim Daly and Kevin Conroy return with, what's his name? Clancy Brown, duh, the Kurgan. As Lex Luthor. Lex Luthor's president, he sets up Superman, and Superman and Batman are declared public enemies of the nation, with the Justice League and the government after them. Such a really, really action-packed animated feature, part of the DC Universe animated original movies from Warner Premiere. It's a fantastic movie, very comic book-like, based upon the same comic. It's an action-packed movie from beginning to end. Christopher Drake's score is fantastic. I just love his music, and yeah, this is one of the better ones, more lighthearted, action-packed with some thrills, but above all, for being a DVD release, it feels very cinematic, and among one of my favorite, not only Batman films, but Superman films and just animated films. If you haven't seen Superman Batman Public Enemies, I would highly, highly recommend it. It is an action-packed thrill ride. Number six on my list is the first feature of Batman Beyond called Batman Beyond Return of the Joker. The PG-13 version. I like the PG version, but oh, the uncut version's so good. I've reviewed some of these movies, so you can check it out on my other YouTube channel. But pretty much it bridges the gap between Batman bridges the gap between Batman the Animated Series and Batman Beyond. And the Joker's come back, and you're wondering, is it the real Joker or an imposter? And you discover what happened to the Joker in between the animated series of Batman and Batman Beyond. And it's the most challenging conflict and just foe that Terry McGinnis, Batman, has faced. And there's a lot of cool stuff. You get to see Barbara Gordon older as a commissioner, Tim Drake, and what happened to that crew. Because in the TV show, you saw what happened to Batman Bruce Wayne, and he's basically helping Terry McGinnis as Batman. But this one gets to explore just a little bit more in that universe and bridge both fans, whether you like Batman Beyond or the animated series or both or one or the other. It's a fantastic and just well-done film. And with the Bruce Timm universe, it's up there with Mask of the Phantasm and among one of my favorites. Number five on my list is Batman Under the Red Hood. Not only is this a great Batman film, but it's one of the better Robin films. Bruce Greenwood surprises me as Batman. I didn't think anybody else could voice him as well as Kevin Conroy. Jensen Ackles as Jason Todd / the Red Hood. Just all around, it's a very thrilling movie. Neil Patrick Harris as Nightwing. Jason Isaacs as Ra's al Ghul. And it's a very action-packed movie. Short, but again, Christopher Drake does the score, and it feels cinematic. This one is another one of those animated films that's up there with Mask of the Phantasm to me. And it's just short, basic, to the point, but I'm not going to give too much away, but pretty much it involves this Red Hood persona killing all the mobsters in Gotham to control crime. He doesn't want to stop it. He knows it can't be stopped, but he knows it can be controlled. Whatever and whoever he is linked to Robin's past, Jason Todd, who dies in the prologue of this film. So Batman has to basically figure out who the Red Hood is, which is pretty much Jason Todd, and it's about, like, how he failed him. Batman's greatest failure is manifested into the Red Hood. And it ties to the Joker, and just everything about this film is just all around just damn awesome. I love this film. It mixes a little bit of CGI and cartoon with the animation, but it's a really, really great film. It's on HBO a lot of the times, but if you haven't seen it there, check it out on either Netflix or like a Blu-ray or DVD. It is a well-crafted animated movie, and it's one of the better ones in the universe. Number four on my list is Batman The Dark Knight Returns. Now, this is a deluxe edition. There's parts one and part two, but it's a complete version. I love the graphic novel, but very few animated films can be just as good or even better than the graphic novel, and this follows it closely. There's Year One, which made the honorable mentions, but like Year One felt a little bit boring. Even though it's exactly like the comic book. It was more exciting to read the comic and the graphic novel. But this is just all around excellent. Peter Weller as Batman. All around just an action-packed dark movie. It's PG-13. Everything from Batman Superman was built from Dark Knight Returns of Frank Miller. This is the reason why Batman became dark again in the 80s. And I love the way the animation is. I made it close to the graphic novel. And yeah, with Peter Weller's voice with RoboCop, it's just an awesome movie. The score has an 80s kind of Escape from New York vibe. I just love it. And both parts put together makes a really long movie that's just enjoyable and feels very cinematic. Not only is it among one of my favorite animated Batman films, but one of my favorite Batman films of all time. If you haven't checked out The Dark Knight Returns, please do. Dark Knight Rises and BVS took a lot from it, and this is from the original source material, and it is fantastic. It takes place in the 80s. If you love Watchmen, if you love Batman, definitely check out The Dark Knight Returns. And before I leave this, I love how it deals with an older Batman coming out of retirement and becoming Batman again. In a way, Ben Affleck, again, took a lot from this role, and it's great seeing how an older Batman is. Now that crime's on the rise again, what Batman is and the symbol he is. And Frank Miller really conveys that well. Not only in the graphic novel, but this animated film really does as well. Number three on my list is the film that got me into Batman in the first place. It's number two on my list for live action, but since I'm including animated, it's Batman 1989. This is a film that in a way started it all. You had Adam West, you had the 60s film, 60s series. People thought Batman was campy. People thought when you punch somebody, it was like, pow, bang, bam, whatever the hell. People thought Batman was that. Tim Burton, This is the most important film, not only because it shaped Batman films, but it shaped superhero films. There would be no Marvel Universe, no superhero movies without this, because this is not only the first one to have Batman be dark, but this, in a way, took the superhero film seriously in the way that, like, Richard Donner's Superman the movie did. But it was dark, made it dark, gritty, kind of grounded while still being comic book-like. You had other movies that were trying to imitate this, like Darkman, The Shadow, The Crow, and then later on elevating to the Marvel Universe, Blade, Spider-Man with Tobey Maguire. I feel like none of those would be possible without this film. Not only because of the way it's set up as being dark and serious, but just taking the material seriously enough to have actors, and then it created the blockbuster element. Now, you could trace it back to Superman the movie, but there is a lot of dead time between Superman the movie and Batman 89, and I feel like Tim Burton reinvented things and really shaped the way we see the superhero blockbuster with Batman 89. Jack Nicholson, regarded as one of the best Jokers of all time, gives an excellent performance. Michael Keaton, you wouldn't suspect Mr. Mom to be a great Batman, but he pulls it off with the intensity of his eyes, everything. Kim Basinger's Vicki Vale, the music, Prince on the soundtrack, Danny Elfman, just all around. Without this, you would not have the animated series and just everything I mentioned before. This is the film that really took Batman seriously, and I feel like, even though it doesn't make the top of my list, it is the most important Batman film to date, and it has to exist. We wouldn't have Batman the way we would know it today without Batman 1989, and I just love so many moments of it. Batwing going up to the moon down, the score. It's like, I made you, you made me first. It's like, where does he get those wonderful toys? And he's like, I want you to tell your friends about me. He's like, what are you? It's just like, I'm Batman. Michael Keaton said, I'm Batman in that way, before Christian Bale and everybody else started saying it. It came from this film. If you haven't seen any Batman films, or only seen the Christopher Nolan ones, check this one out. This one is up there and blows the other ones in the anthology out of the water. So you may ask, if Batman 89 is number 3, what is in number 2, number 1? Well, number 2 is Batman Mask of the Phantasm from 1993. It was made by the people from the animated series. It had a theatrical release. I did a review of this on my other channel, but yeah, Mask of the Phantasm is fantastic. It's almost like the Citizen Kane of Batman as far as like the way it's formatted. A lot of it was based off of Citizen Kane by Orson Welles, Kevin Conroy, Mark Hamill, Dana Delany as Andrea Beaumont, just a whole bunch of actors. It's just very cinematic, but there's a story of a phantasm going after mobsters, and he has to figure out who the phantasm is. People think it's Batman killing all these people, when it's really the phantasm. It ties into the Joker, and it also ties into Bruce's past. And throughout the film, as he's trying to figure out the mystery of who the phantasm is, we get flashbacks to younger Bruce Wayne, of him before he's Batman, how he comes to be Batman. So in a way, it was an origin story before Batman Begins. And before Batman Begins, the Dark Knight trilogy, this was my favorite Batman film when you count animation. It is a superb film. And even Gene Siskel on At the Movies regretted not reviewing it when it came out, because later on when he did, said it was better than the live-action Batman films. Do not underestimate it. There's cartoons, and then there's stuff like this that's animated movies. And it is fantastic from the crew of the animated series. It's no wonder they won Emmys, and it's no wonder they made this brilliant piece of film. It is one of the best Batman stories, and if you have never seen the animated series or Mask of the Phantasm, definitely check it out. It is one of the best Batman movies ever made. So that brings me to number one. And number one is going to be kind of, well, not really controversial, but like, there's three films in number one. And as you may know, it's the Dark Knight trilogy. Batman Begins, The Dark Knight, and The Dark Knight Rises make my number one. After Batman and Robin came out, there was 8 years of nothing. Like, Batman was dead. Dead. You may have had some remnants of the animated series and Batman Beyond, but that was it. No merchandise, no nothing. And Batman Begins was a game changer. It brought us the Batman movie we all know we wanted to see and that we were waiting for. It did what Mask of the Phantasm did in a way, but in live action, you had the origins of Bruce Wayne. But most of all, it made Batman Bruce Wayne the main character. He wasn't playing second fiddle to the villains. At least not in Batman Begins, and it was fantastic. Christian Bale really changed the game. He didn't really have that much competition topping George Clooney. The way he did the voice, Christopher Nolan's direction, it took Batman seriously. Grounded it, but took it seriously. Took the material seriously. And that's what I love about the films. This is one of my favorite trilogies, along with the Star Wars original trilogy. And there's some days where I have more of a favorite than the other, but it's like Star Wars where I like all three. Some may argue, like Empire Strikes Back, that Dark Knight is the best made one, which I can agree. But there's some days where I really love Dark Knight Rises, even though that, like Return of the Jedi, gets criticized. And then there's Batman Begins that started it all, and I really love Batman Begins because it's a Bruce Wayne story. But then you have the Joker with Heath Ledger, just brilliant performance, and then Tom Hardy, Bane, and Anne Hathaway. Whole last 30 minutes of Dark Knight Rises, that fight scene. Just everything's great, so I love all three equally. Some of them have their pros and cons. I enjoy some over the others, whatever mood I'm in, but we have three well-made, just fantastic Batman films. Great Batman films. And I knew after Dark Knight Rises that I wouldn't see any Batman films this well made in a long time, but at least we have three. I was only asking for one, but we have three almost like perfect Batman films. And yeah, I love the Dark Knight trilogy. Say what you will about Tim Burton starting it and then the Marvel movies, but like, this brought Batman back to life, brought the new renaissance we see today, but it showed us what we can do with a superhero, with a comic book-based movie. It's an insult to call these comic book-based films. They're just great works of cinema. They're great films, period. It took us above comic books. They just made three great films, and Christopher Nolan is a master filmmaker, and vastly underrated, I feel. And he made three well-crafted Batman films, and it's nice to see a group of people in the cast and crew care about the material and just give a damn about telling a great story. Don't care about toys, money, but just care about telling a great story, knowing that everything else will fall into place. And yeah, these are three great films. Yeah, you heard me talk about those films a lot, but I just love so many moments. There's so many moments I love that. We're just like, you wanted me, here I am. And then where's the trigger, and just stuff like that. Christian Bale's voice is just awesome, and Bane and Joker was just like, a year ago, these cops and lawyers wouldn't dare cross any of you. I mean, what happened? Your balls drop off or something? You're just like, why so serious? Great voices in Bane, and in a way, the Dark Knight trilogy did what Superman the movie did. Have big named actors in the supporting roles, and then get a kind of an actor, but kind of an unknown at the time, Christian Bale, Christopher Reeve. Having surrounded by all these fantastic actors and doing that, it gave it a level of gravitas that would otherwise be missing if you did it another way. But yeah, I can go on and on about those films, but those are my favorite. My camera battery is about to go out, but yeah, let me know what films did not make the list. And yeah, in the comments below, let me know your favorite films. And thank you for watching. I did this in anticipation for Lego Batman, and after doing videos, I thought I would share some of my personal favorites to y'all out there. I thank you for watching, and if you like, comment, subscribe, do whatever, and yeah, until then, I hope you all have a great day, and that is my list. Until next time, it's not who I am underneath, but what I do that defines me. That was too deep. Guess what, kids? I'm Batman.